Very briefly at the top, and I'll take your questions. Well, after more than two years of dedicated leadership and service to the Department of State, Deputy Secretary Jim Steinberg will embark on a new journey as Dean of the Maxwell School at Syracuse University, an institution near and dear to me as the alma mater of my sister Robin. There, he'll help shape the next generation of American public leaders and thinkers. Deputy Steinberg's counsel has been invaluable in guiding the department and our nation's foreign policy. His wisdom and experience will be deeply missed, and we wish him all the best in his future endeavors. Go Orange, Orangeman, is that it? Yeah, go Orange. Sorry. What's that?
Sister.
Oh. That's okay. Let's go to our questions, guys.
You didn't want to make your the intended.
No, I'd refer you to the White House on.
Okay.
On those kinds of decisions.
All right. who might be the new P?
Refer you to the White House.
That, I think that's a. Isn't that a? The White House doesn't have anything to do with that.
Oh, and the new P. I apologize, Matt. I wasn't paying attention. I don't have anything to announce on that.
All right. And you don't want to say anything about the Human Rights Council, since you put out a statement about it at 6:30 in the morning? Were you actually up when that
was? I was out. I was up. I'd already run 5 miles. Nothing to add. I mean, just to amplify the statement itself, which underscored the fact that U.S. engagement in the Human Rights Council resulted in real progress for the council, we believe, and that it's led to a substantial track record, positive track record, at the council since joining it, the U.S., and we remain determined to continue to push the council in this positive direction. And to this end, we intend to pursue a second term of the council at the HRC elections in New York in May of 2012.
What's the track record?
Well, we put out a fact sheet that elaborates on that, but just to, you know, we've helped to mobilize the council's will to address serious problems in Libya, Iran, Guinea, Cote d'Ivoire, Kyrgyzstan, and elsewhere for the first time.
But what actions stem from on the ground from our participation in the Human Rights Council? How did it make the world better? That's what I'm asking.
Well, just to use an example of Iran, the people of Iran now have a voice at the UN to speak for them and to raise their concerns internationally. Countries can no longer claim international sanctions for blasphemy laws, and certainly women's rights and issues related to sexual orientation, freedom of expression and assembly. And all these issues have been raised in support of the council, and this is due to U.S. leadership.
You cited in your statement this morning that you have these continued concerns about their disproportionate focus on Israel. Over the course of the U.S. Presence on the council, have you seen any progress at all in decreasing that focus? Do you think it's less disproportionate than it was 2 years ago?
I can't cite real progress in that front, but we're obviously working in good faith with member states to address those kinds of issues.
Got it on this?
Yep. Yeah, sure. Go ahead.
The Syrian government applied yesterday to join the council. Will the U.S. support them? Membership?
I'd refer you to our mission in New York, but for more details. But you know, Syria's track record on human rights is subpar.
So, carrying on there that theme, what did you make of Bashar Assad's speech?
Well, I mean, ultimately, it's going to be the Syrian people, obviously, who are the ones that judge what they heard today, and whether or not President Assad demonstrated positive movement forward in meeting their aspirations and in hearing their call for political and economic and social reform. But we expect they're going to be disappointed. We feel the speech fell short with respect to the kinds of reforms that the Syrian people demanded. And what President Assad's own advisors suggested was coming.
Will you make your feelings known to the Syrians in any way? Will Ambassador Ford be speaking with them, or will you be speaking with the Syrians?
I think I've done so publicly, but obviously Ambassador Ford does remain engaged on the ground in Damascus.
Right, but I mean, there is a slight difference between you saying it from the podium and then someone actually going face-to-face to the embassy here or bringing them to the
I can't confirm if he has already, but I've no doubt he will.
Can you address President Assad's assertion that there are conspiracies over the Syrian homeland that are responsible for the unrest there?
His assertion is that there are...
Conspiracies over the homeland was the way he put it?
He's confronted with popular demonstrations calling for change. We've seen these kind of demonstrations all over the Middle East. And it goes back to the Secretary's speech in Doha that leaderships of many of these countries need to respond to the legitimate aspirations of their people. It's far too easy to look for conspiracy theories and respond in a meaningful way for the call for reform.
Were you expecting that at least he would take some concrete steps like lifting the martial law?
I think we said that.
Specifically on the martial law, were you expecting that he would at least come out and say, today we lift the martial law?
I think those are the kinds of reforms I made mention to. The emergency law is incompatible with the rights of citizens who are seeking to exercise their universal aspirations and rights.
Okay, Mark, just a quick follow-up. You said that the Syrians will be, it's less than what they expected. Are you disappointed? Were you expecting something else in his speech?
Again, Saab, it's not for us to, I mean, it's ultimately the Syrian people who are going to judge the merits of this speech from what they heard today. But I think it's clear to us that it didn't really have much substance to it and didn't talk about specific reforms as was suggested in the run-up to the speech.
Okay, and lastly, have you been reassured or in any way told indirectly that, consistent with Ms. Chaban said last week, that the martial law will be lifted in the foreseeable future?
I think we would be hopeful that it would be. It would be the kind of step that would indicate reform.
Thank you. Any suggestions as to how the Syrian people should vent their disappointment with the with the speech?
We understand that protests are scheduled, I believe, for Friday, and obviously we would strongly condemn any violence against those protesters. And at the same time, we've been consistent in saying that demonstrators need to pursue a peaceful path.
Do you support them?
Do we support the demonstrators? We support the rights of all citizens throughout the Middle East and North Africa to express their universal aspirations.
So it's fair to say that you have concerns, given what has happened and the crackdown that's happened so far in Syria, that you do have concerns.
I think we do have concerns.
Something similar
given,
might happen
yes,
on Friday.
Yes.
How central is Syria to the success of the Obama administration's Mideast policy?
Well, I mean, when you're talking about, for example, one of the priorities, which is Middle East peace, obviously there's a regional aspect to that in which Syria is a part of. We've long called for Syria to play a more constructive role in the region, and we believe that it's important that it does so in order to meet those goals of a comprehensive peace, for example, between Israel and Palestine. But also to increase stability across the region.
Is it safe to say at this point, more than 2 years into this administration, that attempts at engagement with Syria have failed?
I think we're always clear-eyed pragmatists about dealing with a government like Syria. But we felt it was important to put somebody at a senior level there, which is why we pushed so hard for Ambassador Ford to go there. At least we're communicating clearly our expectations and able to convey our concerns directly to the Syrian government.
Have attempts at engagement failed?
As I said, it's not a situation that we thought would be easy, but we feel it's important to communicate clearly our expectations, our concerns to the Syrian government. Ultimately, we can't. We can't tell the Syrian government what to do or compel them to action.
Are you disappointed that the administration did everything possible and sent in Ambassador Ford, as a matter of fact, while Congress was not in session? Are you disappointed that the Syrians now they've sort of put you in a difficult position, untenable situation, that they should have responded in a different way, a more positive way?
Well, I mean, you'll have to ask the Syrian government. I think that, you know, that governments across the region, and certainly Syria is no exception, are dealing with a popular call for reform. And these governments need to be responsive, and Syria is no exception.
Still consider President Assad a reformer after the speech today?
I don't think she ever called him a reformer. I think she referred to members of Congress. Yeah. Again, I think we're looking for actions versus words. Yeah, Andy had a
On Syria, are you able to characterize the rebellion in Syria? You know, the General Stavridis has said yesterday in Senate that we cannot profile the rebels in Libya, for example. There is no evidence relate that they are related to terrorist groups, but we cannot be sure about their profile. What about Syria?
Well, we're I think in a more fortunate position in Syria because we do have an embassy there, and we do have contacts, a wide variety of contacts among the opposition. But you know, it's always difficult to characterize these types of movement beyond the fact that we're seeing you know, a popular expression and a call for these universal rights, and we respect those. Bahrain. Yes, sure.
Bahrain. Seems like they're continuing a crackdown on Shiite opposition, despite your calls, and they've arrested a well-known blogger, a Shiite blogger. Firstly, do you have any reaction to the arrest? Secondly, do you have any? Can you give us any sense of whether you think things are going in the right or wrong direction in Bahrain? And there's also a report by Human Rights Watch that they are actively targeting people who are injured in these anti-government protests who are in the hospital, beating them up and so on. Do you have any information on that?
In your first question concerning the Bahraini blogger Mahmoud Al-Yusuf, well, we're deeply concerned about his arrest. He's a prominent and respected blogger. We're also concerned about reports of the detention of two other internet activists who have expressed their views on recent events in Bahrain. We hope that the Bahraini government's decision to arrest bloggers and internet activists will not make it more difficult to resume a national dialogue that solicits the views and opinions of all Bahrainis. And I think that pivots to your second question, which is, you mentioned about going into hospitals and other places.
Human Rights Watch report, right.
Right, I think we've been clear in previous statements that we're obviously very concerned about those kinds of reports. We condemn the violence against civilians and peaceful protesters, and we continue to call for a credible political process. As Secretary said many times, there's no security solution to the situation in Bahrain. It needs to be a political one.
You said in relation to the arrests that you hope that it will not make it more difficult to engage in the national dialogue. Does that mean that you're telling the protesters that they should basically turn the other cheek and ignore this?
Well,
or are you telling the government that they should be released?
I think we're saying that the Bahraini government needs to engage in that kind of national dialogue, as does the opposition, in order to move this process forward, and that arresting bloggers doesn't help in that respect.
Still on Bahrain?
No.
Well, I want to go to Libya.
No.
Libya, everyone? Okay.
If that's okay. I read this morning in a major newspaper that apparently there is a, quote, fierce debate, end quote, going on within the administration about arming the Libyan rebels, which is a bit of a surprise to me because it doesn't seem like there's been any decision made on this, and if there is a debate, it would appear to be a debate between those who are stressing caution and those who are stressing more caution. Who's right?
You know, the newspaper report, notwithstanding that you refer to, we've been pretty consistent and clear on the question of arming the rebels, which is that we haven't ruled it out. It's still under consideration, but no decisions have been made one way or the other.
Okay, but who?
But also to stress
that. Are you aware of anyone in the administration who's actively pushing, actively out there saying that they should be armed?
I'm not going to characterize what internal discussions may be, but not that I'm aware of. But I'm not going to attempt to characterize any kind of interagency or intergovernmental debate beyond what I've just said.
Are you aware of anyone in the government who is saying anything other than let's be cautious and wait and see what the rebels are, who they are, what their aims are, and what their capabilities are?
I think we've been clear about the point that we're still getting to know the opposition. And while they've said many of the right things, and we've looked to establish broader contacts with them through both Ambassador Kretz through his work and also with our envoy, and also the secretary's meetings in London, that we're trying to deepen our contact and relationship with them, but we're still finding out who they are as an entity.
Mark, I was wondering, there seems to be a different interpretation between the United States and some other members of the Security Council on what actually is allowed under 1973, and that was spotlit yesterday by the Secretary's comments where she said it's our understanding that it does allow some wiggle room if there were a decision to be made to arm the rebels, whereas you have completely contradictory comments coming from other members of the Security Council. I'm just wondering if there's been any communication, any sense, any attempt to actually establish what the legal framework is here before we even talk about whether or not it's going to be done. Is the U.S. going to try and reach common understanding with other members of the Sanctions Committee particularly?
Well, it's a fair question, and I'd refer you to our mission at the U.N. for the details of any dialogue or conversations that are going on there. Our position is that resolutions 1970 and 1973 neither specify nor preclude such an action, so that it would allow it, would allow the possibility of arming the rebels. Yeah, sure.
Now, are you prepared, or do you discuss the eventuality of armed rebel civilian groups fighting armed loyal civilian groups, and how is that juxtaposed with 1970 and 1973?
These are all considerations, obviously, and you know, there's a lot of hypothetical situations that could come up in Libya. That's why we're trying to stay focused right now on the implementation of 1973 and the civilian protection aspects of that, as well as the humanitarian assistance. You know, are we thinking of possible scenarios? Sure. I mean, that's prudent planning. But right now, our clear focus is on the implementation of UN Security Council Resolution 1973. And then, obviously, with the broader political goal of convincing Colonel Gaddafi to step down.
Is it fair to say that until you get a better handle on who the rebels are, their aims and their intentions and their capabilities, that any fierce debate inside the administration on arming them is not, that will have to wait until a decision will have to wait until you have a better idea of who they are?
Well, I don't want to try to characterize the conversations that are going on, but I think that we're looking at many different ways to assist the opposition, and Secretary's spoken to that, President's spoken to that, and Ambassador Rice at the UN spoken to that, but obviously we're seeking to understand them better, and while that remains under consideration, we're still trying to get them, trying to understand more about the opposition.
Right. Without getting into any internal discussions, I mean, is it fair to say that a decision on arming them, or even providing them different types of aid or recognition, depends on your analysis, assessment of who they are, what they want, and what they can do?
I think that our assessment will help define our actions as we move forward. Yeah, Paul.
There have been varying comments from different officials of the government about to what extent there's a threat of extremism and extremists in eastern Libya in particular. How much of a factor is that in the administration's caution about arming the opposition?
Mm-hmm. Well, I mean, it's obviously a concern. We're aware of it, and it's obviously being something that we're considering as we're that as you mentioned, the possibility that AQ or Al-Qaeda or Al-Qaeda IM, as it's called in the Maghreb, is looking to take advantage of the situation. That's part of our overall assessment, absolutely.
Has the special envoy traveled to Benghazi or not yet?
Not yet.
When?
I don't have a date for that. It depends, as I've said repeatedly, on the security situation. Yeah, James, and then the back.
Mark, does the United States want these Libyan rebels to prevail?
We want, I think, a resolution to the situation in Libya, one that involves Mr. Gaddafi stepping away from power. How that's achieved is really a matter for the Libyan people.
Do you regard it as being within our capabilities to supply arms to these Libyan rebels?
Well,
is it something that if we decided to do it, we could?
That's an operational or military aspect that, or a question that I can't answer from here. I think I can just speak to the UN Security Council resolution, and we believe it does not preclude that option.
Are you precluded from saying whether you want them to win?
I think that we want actions on the ground in Libya to lead to a democratic transition.
You've got a hot war going on.
And obviously the violence is of concern. We believe that the choice is really for Colonel Gaddafi to make. He's delegitimized as a leader, and he needs to step away and allow for that peaceful transition to take place.
So you want to help civilians, but not necessarily the rebels?
Well, UN Security Council Resolution 1973 is in support of the civilian population and their protection.
So the rebels are on their own?
Look, I mean, we've been quite clear that we've reached out to the opposition, that we're working with them, that we're trying to assist them in their efforts to bring about that transition to a democratic process.
So you do want them to win?
We want to see, I don't know how I can be more clear in saying that what we want to see emerge is Gaddafi to step down, to see a peaceful transition to a democratic process. The opposition will obviously play, the Transitional National Council will obviously play an important role in that process, but that's our goal. That the specific goal of UN Security Council Resolution 1973 is to help protect the civilian population that at present is under attack from Gaddafi's forces. Sean?
Is it safe to say that until Chris Stevens arrives and makes a decision?
No, I don't want to say that because we're in contact with them in London. Ambassador Kretz is in contact with them. But certainly that will help our overall assessment and allow us to better assess their needs. Yeah, Andy.
There was more than a suggestion. It was said that they were going to open a representative office here in Washington. Do you know if that's actually up and running?
I don't. I'll have to check on the status of that. That's a good question.
Okay. And then yesterday, the secretary said that in her discussions with the Transitional Council people, that there was some talk about financial assistance, how we might help them out.
Right.
But there were no specifics. I'm just wondering if you could give us any thinking on how the international community, and specifically the United States, could help them with their finances?
Well, I don't have many specific details. I think those options are still being assessed and as we move forward and trying to find practical ways that we can help them. I mean, obviously, the $32 billion, I believe it is, more or less, is being held and safeguarded to be returned to the Libyan people at some point. But I think there's many different options being considered. I don't have I can try to find out more.
This trip to Benghazi that Mr. Stevens is taking, can you just start from zero on that and tell us what that's about and who's going? And
you mean the envoy?
Yeah, please.
He's not. I mean, there's been no trip yet, obviously, he's an individual who will give us a better assessment once he's able to go into Libya. And again, his safety, frankly, is paramount here, and that's our utmost consideration right now in deciding whether to deploy him to Benghazi. But once there, he'll work, with the opposition, try to get a better picture of their needs, try to assess how we can better assist them, and really try to fill in the picture and the gaps that we know about the opposition, but also to strengthen our ability to support them.
Is he going to need a visa? Is he going to need a visa to get into Libya?
I'm not aware. I imagine that's all being worked out, but I don't know if he'll need an official visa or not.
According to the reports today, the Turkish Foreign Affairs Minister gave a roadmap to Madam Secretary, and Madam Secretary said, yes, it's a good plan. So first part of the plan is there will be a ceasefire in Libya, and the second, Gaddafi will leave. The third part, there will be political parties, etc.
There's a lot of different plans and ideas being bandied about. I would just refer back to yesterday, which is we have a contact group established that is looking at the political process as we move forward. And now NATO's in control of the UN Security Council Resolution 1973 implementation. But this contact group will help move the political process forward. Yeah.
Have you been able to figure out what Moussa Koussa is doing in Tripoli? I mean, in Tunisia?
In Tunisia. I have not gotten a clear picture. I'll ask.
And also,
it
seems like there are countries, or at least one country, coming forward saying they'd be willing to take Gaddafi in exile. Do you have any
comment on details. That? I think I was just saying we've seen a lot of different plans and a lot of different ideas. You know, that's not, you know, the UN, you know, the...
Well, do you have a preferred, is there a preferred U.S. destination for Gaddafi, other than perhaps the Netherlands?
I mean, that's a good answer. I think what's important is that he does not get a free pass. He's held accountable for his actions, as are his regime.
According to the Turkish plan, Gaddafi will not leave Libya, but it will be Mubarak case, and it will be living in within the Libya.
I mean, ultimately, you know, this is a Libyan question, a Libyan process, but. But what's important is that, as I said, that you know, the UN is going to hold him accountable for his actions. Sure.
Said on providing financial aid. Did you say that the frozen fund, $32 billion or whatever, could conceivably be used to finance?
I think it's being held. We it's been obviously frozen from Colonel Gaddafi, and it's being held for the Libyan people. I mean,
Then. Is it conceivably, could it be used to finance the rebel or finance the humanitarian needs of people in Benghazi?
Again, we're looking at a variety of ways to assist them, including financial, but I don't have any details right now.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Can I take this option?
Sure.
North Korean delegation met with former U.S. officials in Germany, and they said they agreed to that the nuclear issue should be resolved through dialogue. Do you have any comment? And did you hear anything from these participants?
I'm sorry, you spoke about the...
The meeting between North Korean delegation and former U.S. officials in China.
Right. You know, we really had no... I mean, this is obviously former U.S. officials, so I would refer you to them for the results of the meeting. We didn't have any contact with them.
Are you going to?
We don't have any plans. I mean...
What she just said?
No, I just refer you to them. Like I said, we didn't have an official presence there. These were private individuals. So.
Any readout from President Carter yet on his trip to Cuba?
Obviously, don't have a readout. We did note that he urged the Cuban government to release Alan Gross and he on humanitarian grounds, and believe he also met with Mr. Gross in prison. We're always disappointed. Yes, that he didn't.
We're always disappointed.
We're always disappointed that he didn't come home with, that he didn't come home with Mr. Gross. We want him to be released immediately on humanitarian grounds.
Can you say? I mean, what do you mean? You're always disappointed in the Cubans?
No, we're always disappointed.
Maybe you get rid of the word always.
Okay. Can't always. We are disappointed that he did not come back with Mr. Gross. So, but we're disappointed in a larger extent because. To a larger extent, because we believe he should have been released long ago, I guess was my...
Thank you.
My reason for always.
Could you share with us anything new or any development, or what is the status of the Israeli-Palestinian talks or the peace process?
We remain hard at work. I don't know that... I don't have... And I can get to, you know... more details on Senator Mitchell and what his immediate plans might be, but you know, I know we remain in contact and we're trying to ultimately get both sides back to the table, and into good faith direct negotiations. You know, obviously recent events have not been helpful. The rockets into Israel and of course the bombing in Jerusalem have not been helpful in creating an atmosphere that's conducive to direct talks.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Just on that, there were a bunch of lawmakers who wrote a letter to Secretary Clinton yesterday saying that she should speak out more about alleged Palestinian incitement of violence against the Israelis. Do you know if she's gotten that letter, and if she has, if she plans to do anything?
I'll confirm if we receive the letter and whether we have a reaction.
Myanmar, the military government, sort of at least on paper, has ceded control to the civilian government following the elections. Do you have any comment on this? Is it a step forward, backward, sideways?
That's a good question. Whether I'll pick either sideways or backwards. Look, I mean, it was a fundamentally flawed electoral process that's now ensured that key military regime figures have continued to dominate the government and all decision making. The fact that they've taken off their uniforms and donned civilian clothes is immaterial. We remain deeply concerned about. Well, yes, in the broader sense, I guess. We remain deeply concerned. That's a good pun. Deeply concerned about Burma's oppressive political environment. We urge Burmese authorities to release all political prisoners, to recognize the legitimacy of the National League for Democracy and all democratic and ethnic opposition political parties, and to enter into a genuine and inclusive dialogue with these groups as a first step towards reconciliation that needs to take place.
What do you think of the sort of near-term prospects for any further outreach on the part of the administration to the Burmese government now, at least as a new face on it? Is there going to be any attempt to kind of figure out?
Well, I don't have anything to announce or even to hint at. Our approach, essential two-track approach, remains the same. We just never said it was going to be easy. We've always been kind of clear-eyed in our expectations about it, but we are committed to that approach. And I think I've just outlined steps that we feel we need to see on the part of the government in order to help move that process forward.
Thank you.
Okay, what's this? Yeah, thanks.